The following was a titration question is about is from an ATP paper for O levels, and the question is about finding the relative molecular mass of an organic acid. So let's read the question. A student did an experiment to find the relative molecular mass of an organic acid. So we are finding the MR of an organic acid, and he's saying that he titrated solution R, an aqueous solution containing 8.5 gram per dm cube of the organic acid. So we have solution R, which is basically an aqueous solution containing 8.5 grams of the organic acid with solution S. So there's a titration going on with solution S, which is containing 0.1 mole per decimeter cube of sodium hydroxide. So there's an alkali acid titration going on. So let's read the steps that are taking place. 25 cm cube of S was transferred into a conical flask and a few drops of phenolphthalein indicator were added. So this is the first step. We are transferring 25 cm cube of S into a conical flask and adding a few drops of phenolphthalein indicator. Let's try and sketch a drawing for this. So this is a conical flask and we are transferring 25 cm cube of S. So this contains 25 centimeter cube of solution S. And what is S? S is 0.1 mole per decimeter cube. That is the concentration of this S, and it is sodium hydroxide, so it is NaOH, 0.1 mole per decimeter cube. So it's written over here, this is solution S containing 0.1 mole per decimeter cube of sodium hydroxide. So we've put that into the conical flask, and then he's saying that R was put into a burette and run into the conical flask containing S until the endpoint is reached. So I'm going to now sketch a burette over here showing that it contains R. Here is our burette and it contains R. It's filled with R. And what was R? It's mentioned over here. R is an aqueous solution containing 8.5 gram per decimeter cube of the organic acid. So this is the organic acid over here in this burette. And the concentration is given in grams per dm cube. So it's 8.50 grams per decimeter cube. So that is the concentration of the organic acid. And he's asking us what was the color change at the end point. Now there's one thing that's been added to the flask, which is that a few drops of phenolphthalein indicator were added. So we're going to write that down. This flask contains phenolphthalein. So phenolphthalein indicator, just a few drops are added. And he's also given us the color of the phenolphthalein. Phenolphthalein is colorless in acid and pink in alkali. So he's also mentioned the colors of the phenolphthalein indicator. So initially, when there was no titration happening, this phenolphthalein was basically in alkali. In alkali, the color of phenolphthalein is going to be, it's going to be pink initially, because he's already mentioned that it's pink in alkali. And when you're adding acid from this burette, this acid is going to neutralize this alkali, which is NaOH. And once all the alkali gets neutralized and this acid goes in excess, when you start adding too much of the acid, this solution in the flask would become acidic. And when it is acidic, the phenolphthalein would change color because the solution is now acidic and it would become colorless. So eventually it's going to become colorless when the organic acid is in excess. And that would indicate that you're adding too much of the organic acid, so you should turn this tap off. So we need to mention the color changes. So what was the color change at the end point? The color changed from pink to colorless. So that is your answer to this part. Now in the next part, he's mentioned that three titrations were done. The diagrams below show parts of the burette with the liquid levels at the beginning and end of each titration. So we have started titration, adding organic acid to this alkali over here to neutralize this alkali. And three separate experiments are done. And burette readings for each experiment is taken. Three separate experiments are done to improve accuracy. More experiments taking the average value of the amount of organic acid that's being added would give you more better and more accurate results if you do more experiments. So this first titration, then there's a second titration, and then there's a third titration, and the burette readings, the initial burette reading and the final burette readings are given for each titration. So starting with the first iteration, we have given a table as well, so we need to fill this table now. Filling this table, let's look at the first iteration. The initial volume in the burette is 0 centimeter cube, and the final burette reading is 26.60 centimeter cube. So we're going to write that down in this table. 0.00 centimeter cube is the initial burette reading, the final burette reading is 26.70 centimeter cube. So the volume of R that's being added is, if you take the difference between the two values, that's the amount of R that's been added to this flask from the burette, which in this case is going to be 26 point, and I think I've this value has been taken incorrectly. It's 26.60, so let's correct that as well. It's not 26.70, it's actually 26.60. So the amount of R that's been added is 26.60 centimeter cube. Moving to the second titration, the initial burette reading gives us 13.60 centimeter cube, and the final burette reading gives us 39.40 centimeter cube. So using my calculator to solve this, the amount of R that's being added is going to be, so let's subtract the two values, it's going to be 39.40 minus 13.60, and the answer is 25.80 centimeter cube. So in the second experiment, the amount of R that's added is 25.80 centimeter cube. And now moving to the third titration, the initial reading is 4.20 and the final is 30.20. So the initial is 4.20 centimeter cube and the final is 30.20 centimeter cube. So the difference in the two burette readings is going to be exactly, it's going to be exactly 26.00 centimeter cube. So we've got three burette readings. In each case, the volume of R in the first one, 26.60, 25.80, and 26. That is the amount of R that's added from the burette. And we have to now take the best titration results. Remember, the best titration results are the ones that are close together, that are consistent. This first value is slightly off, so we're going to ignore this value because there must be some experimental error in this value. The other two values are close to each other, so we're going to pick and select the values that are close to each other. So 25.80 and 26.00 centimeter cube are going to be our best titration results. And after that, using these results, the average volume of R was, we have to find the average volume of R. So using these two results, we're going to find the average, which is going to be the average of these two values. So it's going to be 25.80 plus, it's going to be 26.00, and I'm going to add them up and divide by 2. And the average volume of R that's being added is going to be 25.90 centimeter cube if I take the average. So coming back to our sketch over here, the volume of R that's being used in the reaction is, the average volume of R is coming out to be 25.90 centimeter cube. So that is the amount of R that's being added from the burette into the flask over here. Now in the next part, part C, we asked to calculate the number of moles of sodium hydroxide in 25 cm cube of S. So S was put into this flask over here, and we know the volume of NaOH, and we also know the concentration of S, which is given as 0.1 mole per decimeter cube. So we're going to simply use the formula for solutions, which is moles is equal to concentration multiplied by volume. And the concentration is given as, it's given as 0.1 mole per decimeter cube, and the volume is given as 25 cm cube, but that should be in dm cube, so I'm going to divide that by 1000. And the answer that I'm going to get is, using my calculator, it's going to be 25 divided by 1000. So 25 divided by 1000 and then multiplied by 0.1, and the answer is 0.0025 moles, 0.0025 moles. So that is the amount of moles of NaOH. So let's write that down. It's 0.0025 moles. So these are the amount of moles of NaOH in this flask over here that have been added. In the next part, part D, he says that given that 1 mole of acid neutralizes 1 mole of NaOH, so he's given the ratio in which the acid, so 1 mole of acid reacts with 1 mole of sodium hydroxide. So use your answer to see, to reduce the number of moles of organic acid in the average volume of R. So what we have found is, what he has already provided, the information is that the mole ratio of NaOH and R, NaOH and R react in 1:1. So they react in 1:1. So if you have 0.025 moles of NaOH, then the amount of R is going to be exactly the same. So R and NaOH, the ratio, so we're going to show some working over here. The mole ratio is 1 mole reacts with 1 mole. So if you have 0.0025 moles of NaOH, then the amount of R is going to be exactly the same. It's going to be 0.0025 moles as well. So that's your answer, 0.0025 moles. And now in the next part, he's asking us to calculate the number of moles of acid in 1 dm cube of R. Now, if you, so we can add this information over here as well. The amount of moles that we got is 0.0025 moles for R. The amount of moles of R and the amount of moles of NaOH are exactly going to be the same. They react in 1:1. Now, moving to the next part states that we need to find the number of moles of acid in 1 dm cube of R. What we have found is, we have found that the acid contains 0.0025 moles, but in 25.90 centimeter cube. So using ratios, what we know is that the acid contains 0.0025 moles, but in what volume it contains those moles in 25.90 centimeter cube. Now he's asking us to find the same, find the moles in 1 dm cube. 1 dm cube is basically equal to 1000 centimeter cube. So we need to find the moles. So let's write x over there. So we need to, using ratios, we need to find the moles in 1000 cm cube. So using the unitary method, and crisscross and multiplying the two values using the unitary method, simple ratios. So it's going to be, so now I'm going to use my calculator, it's going to be 0.0025. That's going to be multiplied by 1000. And then it's going to be divided by 25.9. And the answer I'm going to get is it's going to be 0.096525 moles. So that would be, according to the ratio, 25.9 cm cube contains these many moles, so 1000 cm cube contains x. And using ratios, the answer that I get is the moles of R in 1 dm cube is going to be 0.096525 moles. You can round this up to three significant figures to give you 0.0965. So moving to the next part, part F. Part F states that using our answer to E, our previous answer, and the information that R contains 8.5 gram per dm cube of the acid, calculate the relative molecular mass of the acid. So we now have to find the relative molecular mass, or the MR of the acid. The information that we have is that 1 dm cube, if we have 1 dm cube solution, it contains 0.096525 moles. So that's the first information that we have from part E, this previous part where we calculated that 25.9 cm cube contains these many moles. So 1000 or 1 dm cube would contain 0.096525 moles. So this is the first information that we have. And if you look at the concentration that's given in grams per dm cube, we also know that 1 dm cube contains how many grams? It contains 8.50 grams. So the concentration is given in grams per dm cube. So 1 dm cube contains 8.5 grams. So if you have 1 dm cube solution, you know the moles and you also know the mass. So if moles and mass are known, moles is equal to mass divided by molar mass. So we're going to use that formula. So if you have 0.096525 moles, moles is equal to mass, which is going to be 8.50 grams divided by the MR. So we can calculate and we can rearrange the terms and find this MR over here. So it's going to be 8.50 divided by 0.096525 moles. So the answer that I'm getting is 88. The MR is going to be equal to the molar mass is going to be equal to 88. So that is the MR of R. So this is for R, this is the MR of R, and that comes out to be equal to 88. And now moving to part G, you found the MR. What we now have to do, G says that the general formula of the organic acid is given, CnH2n plus 1, COOH. Calculate the value of N in the formula for the organic acid in R. Now we know the MR is 88, which means that if you sum up the atomic masses of all the elements in the formula, that should be equal to 88. Now the formula is in terms of N. So starting with carbon, we have 12, carbon has an AR of 12, but we have N carbon atoms, so that's 12 into N. Then you have hydrogen. Hydrogen has an atomic mass of 1, but there are 2N plus 1 hydrogen atoms, so I'm going to multiply it by 2N plus 1. Plus there's 1 carbon and there are 2 oxygens, so that's 32. Plus you have 1 more hydrogen, so that's 1. So I'm going to try and simplify and solve this for N. So it's going to be 12N plus 2N plus 1 plus 12 plus 32 and plus 1. And I'm going to try and solve this now using my calculator. So it's going to be 14N on one side. So this would be equal to 14N. And on the other side, it's going to be 88 minus 32 plus 12 is it's going to be 44 plus 2 is 46. It's going to be 88 minus 46. And solving this on my calculator. So 88 minus 46 is 42. So it's going to be 42 divided by 14 is equal to N. So N comes out to be equal to 3. So we now know the value of N, which comes out to be equal to 3. And in part 2 of this part, you're now asked to deduce the formula for the organic acid in R. So we can, the formula of the organic acid in R is going to be, let's put N equal to 3. So it's going to be C3. H is 2N plus 1, so it's 6 plus 7, so that's 7. And CO2H. So what I've done is I've substituted N in the formula and I get C3H7 and CO2H. So this acid over here is called propanoic acid, if you're familiar with organic chemistry. So this is propanoic acid. And moving to the next part, part H, which is the last part of the question as well. The question states that the sample of the organic acid was reacted with an excess of ethanol in the presence of small volume of concentrated sulfuric acid to give an organic product T and water. And we have to suggest the formula of T. Now this is an alcohol, and we are reacting this alcohol with propanoic acid, which is C3H7 COOH. Now, whenever a carboxylic acid reacts with an alcohol in the presence of concentrated sulfuric acid, an ester would be formed. So I'm going to first write this structural formula. The way the ester would be formed is, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw the displayed formula for propanoic acid. So I'm going to try and draw the displayed. There would be two hydrogens over here. So it's going to be C3H7COH. This is actually butanoic acid. Because there are four carbons, so this is butanoic acid. So correct this. This is not propanoic acid. It is butanoic acid because it has four carbon atoms. So this is my butanoic acid, C3H7 and COOH. I've drawn the displayed formula. The alcohol is ethanol, C2H5OH, so it contains two carbons. So that is the ethanol, C2H5OH. What you're going to do is you're going to draw the two functional groups in front of each other. So I've drawn this molecule in the other way. I've mirrored this molecule. Its position has been changed and rotated. The OH is pointing in this direction, so both functional groups are pointing towards each other. And when an ester is formed between the two, the carboxylic acid loses its OH and the alcohol loses its H. So this is removed. And what happens is that this carbon then bonds, goes, so let's remove that. So this part is removed. So we're going to remove this part. They end up forming water molecules. And this carbon, because it loses one of its bond, it's going to bond with the oxygen on the other side. So this is going to be the structural formula. or the displayed formula of the ester. So we need to find the formula for T. So this would be correct as well, but there's a shorter version of this. This entire thing over here is C3H7. So this part over here till here is C3H7. Then you have a CO bond followed by another oxygen, and then you have this thing is C2H5, so it's C2H5. So the compressed notation of this formula for T, the ester, is going to be C3H7COOC2H5, and you're now asked to which homologous series does T belong to. So we've already said and mentioned several times that it is an ester, so it belongs to the ester homologous series, and that's our final answer.